speaking of resistance in New York, and speaking of right, left, and other nonsense, I went to the beautiful celebration of life at Union Square a couple of weeks ago, and it was fascinating because it was such a diverse gathering, and there was such love and just basic human contact and amazing African music and dancing and hugs and all those good things. And they were also obvious infiltrators, you know, with Confederate flags and specific visual cues that were just, they were really trying to attract attention. And there was this alleged Trump supporter wearing a mask with a flag up to this and trying to incite. I mean, it was not, the infiltrators were extremely distinctive. I mean, it was very visible that they were not there for the reason that most people were there. And the speakers were diverse, and the crowd was diverse, and there was this love, and people were getting along. And it was going, you know, they had different ideologies, they had different politics, but nobody cared. People were just talking. And then, of course, if you read Twitter a couple of days later, you would think that it was a bunch of right-wingers, and it was so... I mean, it was the first time when I saw it with my own eyes. There was even some kind of a squabble over alleged racial issues, and it looked like they were two actors. I mean, I don't know, obviously, but it didn't even look organic at all.
Right.
So, and I heard similar stories even from the Capitol Hill in Washington, where it was just a party, more or less. You know, my friend was telling me it was like Michael Jackson music playing and people just hanging out. And then all of a sudden, boom, this thing happens and nobody knows what's happening. So it is really fascinating. And, well, fascinating and sad. And you, out of people, you've been a dissident and a conspiracy theorist for longer than most of us.
Yeah.
So today is no news to you. It's just harsher. And I think before they were just a few topics that people couldn't talk about and keep their respectable job. And now it seems like everything, and it's unpredictable, because all of a sudden, maybe tomorrow you can't talk about, I don't know, wind from the north. And then somebody declares that it's a forbidden topic and then you can't talk about it. But the moment is indeed dire. And what I think about a lot, and it just so happens I had a lot of questions. You preemptively answered most of them. Maybe it's because we talked before, maybe because we think similarly on many topics. But what I don't want to happen is further splits, because historically, if we look at how all bad things won, that was by divide and conquer.
Absolutely.
And we as human beings, we all have egos, we all have our preferences, and I personally do not know any one human being on this planet with whom I agree on absolutely everything. Like, not one. And there are a few who I respect deeply, and I would do anything for them. And, you know, still, everybody has their own unique perspective. So I think that if we expect people to agree on us with most of our talking points, and only then we're friends, and only then we respect them, or we treat them well, then we're not going to get anywhere. We might as well just give up now and, you know, just get our yoke and be prepared for the life of slavery for generations to come. So if we're going to fight with each other. So I think that the most important thing we can do, and that is my feeling, I it's not an answer, it's not universal, but this is how I feel strongly about it right now, is that what we really have to work on is our own internal integrity and treating others with respect, genuinely, and trying to see their soul and trying to see their perspective. And granted, yes, they're insiders and they're people who are extremely aggressive or disrespectful, then I guess you ignore them. But if somebody is not trying to undermine you explicitly, then you might as well just see their soul and try to cooperate with them and try to find common grounds. Because what we're up against is too dangerous and it's too big. And they have the money and they have the power, they have the media, they can bribe anybody. And we just really have to seek alliances and seek friendships and cooperation in something that goes way beyond politics or any of those things. It's indeed existential and philosophical and theological. However, you know, theology is a complicated issue, but existential and spiritual. So I don't see any other way, honestly. And I think that the way nature works, the way life works, is what people do. We try to be our best selves. We try to act with integrity. We try to be brave. And then nature takes care of the rest. I mean, we just try to do our best and hope that the universe will help us, because each single one of us is too small to tackle any of that. Yeah. The Great Reset and the censorship and all those abuses against the environment, and now with the nanoparticles and the smart dust, and this pollution is unthinkable. I mean, when you think about it, there's no way to solve it. I mean, how do you solve it? You don't know. But I think that nature has wisdom, and we just have to do our best right now and not fight with each other.
Amen. That's absolutely true. Divide and conquer has been the primary weapon in the imperial playbook since the Romans, if not even earlier. You get people fighting each other instead of yourself, right? Because they outnumber you. So you distract them, right? And the red-blue thing is a distraction. The left-right thing is a distraction. Just as I saw, I came late to the rally in Union Square, and I missed all the beauty. I was there toward the end, and I saw this suspicious-looking face-off between a white and a black attendee, you know. And there was no media present, but if there had been, it would have gotten all the coverage, and apparently that kind of thing did get noted on Twitter. They have this kind of thing down, you know. They know how to weaponize protest, basically. You know, the BLM protests were encouraged and blessed and given weird exemption from the COVID rules, you know, because the cause was righteous. I guess the virus took a vacation. It's completely irrational. But those were okay. Greta Thunberg's protests, perfectly okay. Tons of coverage. I mean, when you see that, you know that the fix is in and that this is all theater, right? But you try to mount your own organic grassroots protest, you are depicted as a certain kind of alt-right menace, and there will inevitably be actors, cops, you know, sent in to disrupt and to infiltrate, and it's very, very hard to deal with that kind of thing. I mean, you know, again, you read the history of the FBI and the CIA and
the KGB.
And the KGB, indeed. You're more open to a certain kind of skepticism when you watch things like Charlottesville, you know. The purpose of all this is to divide us. And 2020 was a year not only of vast immiseration, countless people, really cruel, murderous policies, but also, I think, a year of unprecedented divisiveness. And it wasn't only Trump and his side that was divisive. You know, the New York Times similarly seized the, you know, that other half of the population as a bunch of, you know, mouth-breathing Klansmen. And I know a lot of those people. And in fact, as Tessa says, the opposition is really very diverse. You know, we have to think of ways to overcome, you know, which is a real challenge when most of our communications are online. It's all under surveillance. And the problem, too, is that figures capable of unifying the population have a way of getting killed, okay? You know, I'm co-producer of this documentary series. It's very ambitious. It's been in the works for some time. It's called Four Died Trying. And it's about the killings of JFK, Malcolm, King, and Bobby. And mainly about the reasons why they were killed. Somewhat about the, you know, logistics of each killing and the questions around them and so on. And what you discover is that all four of them, even Malcolm, after his transcendence of what he considered to be his racist past in the Nation of Islam and before. All four of them were in various ways unifying figures. JFK would have swept to re-election over Barry Goldwater, and he had a lot of support. People really liked his peace program, you know, over which he was murdered. But they didn't want him to be reelected. They would never have allowed that, never in a million years. He was really a dead man, you know, because he was upending way too much and disturbing interests of way too much power for him to be allowed another 4 years according to the will of the electorate. Malcolm was, his unification had more to do with people in favor of civil rights in this country with independent African nations, and was working very hard to put American racism on the table at the UN, which would have shown a spotlight on it, a global spotlight on it. And in the propaganda war with the Soviet Union, that couldn't be allowed because the Soviets were always, naturally, pointing to racism in the US as an example of how hypocritical the West was in yakking about freedom and equality all the time. That couldn't be allowed to happen. King was not marked for extermination until he moved away from an exclusive focus on the civil rights struggles in the US, primarily the South, and criticized the war in Vietnam, which he did at Riverside Church uptown here, a year to the day before he was gunned down. And even more threateningly, he was organizing a poor people's march on Washington. Okay, this would not be a black people's march, this would be a poor people's march. So there would be people of all colors, the deprived, the have-nots of all colors would have descended on Washington. Forget it, wasn't gonna happen, okay? And Bobby Kennedy, who was a changed man after the murder of his brother, and was really loved by black people and by working class whites, right? Now, this is the kind of unity that was sort of smashed for good through Richard Nixon's Southern strategy, in part, which he used to pry working class whites away from the Democratic Party by identifying the Democratic Party with the unrest and the rioting in the ghettos in the US. And that was the beginning of a process that was accelerated under Reagan, who attracted a lot of white working class support by dog whistling various racist ideas or implications. Bobby would have been elected president, and he would have, you know, quietly urged an investigation of Dallas, right? But he also would have continued the whole Kennedy program of economic development to grow the middle class. You know, they weren't socialists, the Kennedys, but they believed in, you know, fair capitalistic competition and small business and so on to enlarge the middle class. They were also opposed to eugenics. This is actually a very important aspect of what made the Kennedys sort of threatening to certain interests, that unlike the Rockefellers and others who were always talking about population control, the Kennedys weren't interested in that. They thought that population could continue to grow if they were adequate economic development to feed people. You know, countries needn't starve. And I think the Kennedys would have been doubtful about the kind of vaccine cultism that we've seen emerge in the world of public health over the last few years. You know, sanitation, clean water systems, things like that could actually do more proper diet, could do more to make people healthy than in, you know, injecting them with a million elixirs, which is what, you know, the medical establishment does now. So anyway, I'm wandering off the point again. The point is that if a leader emerges who is capable of uniting warring factions, that leader had better have tip-top security, okay? And there's a fifth figure I'll mention, falls into the same category. That's Fred Hampton, okay? Fred Hampton, the chairman of the Illinois chapter of the Black Panther Party, extremely charismatic, highly intelligent, great organizer. I saw him speak when I was a college student. He spoke downtown in Chicago. He was really riveting. And what we understand about his appeal and what I think motivated his murder, I mean, he was executed in cold blood. He was shot in the head while he was asleep because an infiltrator had drugged his wine at dinner, was the fact that his following was biracial, multiracial. It was a documentary, Murder of Fred Hampton, came out in 1971. He was killed in 69. Just cinema verite, they followed him around, you know. And he's talking to these rooms of people, they're black and white, right? All sitting together, and he's radical. You know, he's talking about capitalism in general. And there's one scene where two guys come to see him, and they have a kind of black separatist movement, and they go to seek his blessing, and he is absolutely uninterested in anything like that. Tells them that is not the way to go, right? He was a real organizer. Now, if you watched the that horrific movie about the Chicago 8 that Aaron Sorkin made, you know, with Sacha Baron Cohen as Abby Hoffman, and they show Fred Hampton, you know, who did indeed provide moral support to Bobby Seale, who was one of the defendants. But in this movie, Hampton is this sullen sort of separatist figure who comes in with a cadre of scowling blacks all around him, and they sit in a little huddled group behind Seale. You know, it's a kind of BLM reimagining of what Hampton's radicalism was all about, okay? He was not a racialist. Whereas now, the so-called left is deeply racialist, you know? They are increasingly and openly, you know, denigrating white people, implying that they're sort of genetically inclined to white supremacy. And, you know, in various kinds of programs nationwide, whites are openly excluded in a way that would be illegal or recognized as illegal if it were the other way around. So that's just an inversion of the old racist model. And at the same time, this left fetishizes black people. You know what I mean? It's like black people are accessories on their outfit. They are signs of one's virtuousness, which I find very patronizing. And I've noticed increasingly throughout the media that there are these very pointed celebrations of black writers or black filmmakers or black musicians, which is, if you think about it, you know, completely racist, because they're not just regarded as musicians and novelists and artists and so on, right? They are black this, they are black that, they are black this. And the New York Times now capitalizes black. So again, it's fetishizing a certain race and using it to symbolize one's own goodness, you know, which is, it's belittling, actually, you know, although seemingly based on a drive for, you know, justice and equality and so on, it just maintains divisions and it still, you know, separates black people in a way. It puts them in a kind of ghetto, although now it's a very attractive ghetto, you know. But it's the racialism of the left that you know, is one of the things that makes me feel like it's become an alien movement, because it's really like a cult, if you know what I mean.
Well, I think about the Soviet Union, for example, and their propaganda, where every building would have signs at the roof talking something about, you know, everything for the people, everything by the people, the workers are great, the workers are celebrated, the workers are amazing, the workers and the peasants, the workers and the peasants, the most amazing, celebrated. And everybody was poor. So there was this great split between the propaganda and the verbal celebration and the verbal dignity. And the fact that people didn't have, well, I guess it depended on where you were, but generally speaking, people were very poor, the life standards were bad, and then there was no dignity in real life, other than from your friends, from your family, which is a whole other matter. So similarly now, I'm just thinking that the top billionaires who are staging this divide, including on ethnic and racial and gender grounds and political grounds, they don't really care about either side. They don't care about white people or black people or purple people or dotted people. They don't care about any of that. They're going to toss whichever figure they're temporarily elevating a little bit right now. You know, they're going to just toss them the moment they get what they want, those billionaires. And it's really tragic. And I think about the generation of my grandparents and the Soviet Union who genuinely believed in the ideas that they went through great hardship for, all the communist ideas. And again, I don't even think that communism is a real thing. I think communism is just extra monopolistic capitalism, and that's just a ghost. That's not a real thing. But in propaganda, it was a real thing. And the generation of my grandparents believed in it. It was their religion. It was sacred to them. They had emotional feelings about it. They kept it until they were old. And then all of a sudden, they found out that they were lied to. Yeah. And that's the most tragic thing I think can happen to a human being. When you live all your life giving great sacrifices for something that you hold sacred, and then when you're old and you don't have that clout and you don't have that power, you don't have that social impact, all of a sudden you find out that you've been duped.
Right.
And I just grew up watching the tragedy, and I guess it really impacted me very strongly. So when I look today at the people who are, say, 20 years old today, and they are deeply, strongly believing in many of those ideas, and you can't blame them because they're kids. You know, like, when you're 20, you usually want to do what's right, and when you usually feel like you know everything, that's kind of just human development.
Right.
And the adults who are lying to them about those ideas, that's a responsibility they'll have to live with, and they'll probably have great regrets. But then those people who are 20 and who are yelling at everybody and think that they're activists by yelling at everybody, then one day they're going to be 60 or 70 and they're going to all of a sudden look back and realize that they've been lied to. This is a horrible feeling. So I actually feel really bad for those who are not going to figure it out on their own sometime soon.
Yeah.
What are the things?